Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Christina Riehman-Murphy, and I'm the Sally W. Callen Librarian for Learning Innovations and a reference of instruction librarian at Penn State Abington.
Hi, I'm Bryan McGeary, and I'm the Learning Design and Open Education Engagement Librarian at Penn State.
And we're looking forward to talking with you about Open Pedagogy Project Management, a roadmap for inclusive, collaborative, and sustainable projects. Please feel free to use the chat for questions if you're joining us live today. And if you're on Twitter, please use the hashtag OEP Roadmap.
So one thing you quickly realize when you start learning about open pedagogy is that nobody can really give you a definitive definition. Some people see it as a set of teaching practices, some see it as a learning style, some see it as more of a set of values and a philosophy, and some people see it as some sort of combination of all of these things. On this slide are a few definitions that we think are useful to consider, but they're certainly not the only good ones that are out there. So when we started creating the Open Pedagogy Project Roadmap, we decided that even if we weren't going to provide some sort of definitive definition of open pedagogy, we still needed to provide some sort of framing so that anyone would know where we're coming from and what we're referring to in terms of open pedagogy. So we looked for commonalities among the many definitions that we've encountered, which you'll see listed here on this slide. So, you know, emphasizing that engagement with students as creators of information rather than just consumers of it. Also highlighting the experiential learning aspect of this work as students are creating. Also the importance of challenging classroom hierarchies and really inviting students into the teaching process through that co-creation of knowledge. Also an emphasis on moving away from single use assignments and working more with situated, collaborative, and renewable types of assignments. And then very importantly, emphasizing the aspect of student agency so that students have a role in deciding, you know, whether or not their work is going to be openly licensed, and then if it is going to be openly licensed, how that work would be shared more broadly. So in addition to these theoretical perspectives that we took away from the scholarly literature on open pedagogy, we also used our own personal experiences with it in order to inform our development of the roadmap. So we thought about the lessons that we learned from those experiences and how those might be more widely applicable. When we got involved with open pedagogy, there wasn't a resource out there to help us think through all these aspects of this work. So we had to learn some things as we went along through trial and error. So part of our motivation behind creating this resource is really to help others avoid having to learn those lessons on the fly. So I'm going to share a little bit about a project that I worked on, and Christina will share about one that she continues to work on so that you have a sense of where we're coming from. And then later, as we explain the different modules of the roadmap, you'll see elements of those experiences reflected in the content of the roadmap. So this first project that I was involved with, it was an open textbook created by students in Dr. Ashwini Ganeshan's Hispanic Linguistics course at Ohio University. And it was really developed out of a need to provide a textbook for the students that was written at a more accessible level, both in terms of the linguistic content that is covered in the book, but also in terms of meeting students where they're at with their level of Spanish language mastery. So it was created over time in a modular fashion, beginning with a study guide assignment, which you see a snippet of on the right side of the slide. And we initially collaborated on revising that study guide assignment. And then over subsequent semesters, additional assignments were used to fill out more pieces of the content of the textbook. So including things like practice exercises and other types of ancillary components. In addition to the students who were creating content in the class itself, some student editors were also hired to help with other aspects of the textbook. So like editing and incorporating some additional content and even recording an audio version of the book. So there is a link, the URL for the textbook itself, if you want to check that out on the left side of the slide. And then on the right side, there is a link to a chapter from the book Open Pedagogy Approaches, if you'd like to read more about this particular project. So in terms of some lessons that we learned from this, first of all, that it's a nonlinear process. Like I said, this was developed in a modular fashion. And so as gaps were identified, new assignments were built into the course to fill out that missing content. In addition to that, an emphasis on grading in a way that kind of alleviates some of the anxiety that students feel about working in this new sort of approach where their work is being shared more widely than they might be used to. And so in this course, assignments were graded on a credit, no credit basis, and students also had opportunities for revision. So they didn't have to obsess as much about, am I going to get a good grade? Because they would have opportunities to revise the work and bring it up to par. And that also helps on the back end of creating this textbook, because you're having to do less work to kind of remediate content if students are improving it as they go along. In addition to that, student agency, very important. So giving students the ability to opt in or opt out and being able to do that without it having any kind of impact on their grade in the course. Also, students in this course were allowed to decide what type of license would be applied to their work. And they decided that as a class. And it was after I did a workshop with them about Creative Commons licensing so that they could really make an informed choice. Also, Dr. Ganeshan chose to include some discussions of some social justice issues in the textbook. So things like the benefits and challenges of being multilingual, the connection between accents and prejudice and things like that, as a way of making it more relevant to students, especially those who weren't going to pursue linguistics as a major or as a career. And then, as I mentioned, also hiring some student editors who had more specialized knowledge, had greater mastery of linguistics and with the Spanish language so that they could do some of the heavy lifting in terms of editing and assembling content and filling in some gaps. An art student was also hired to do some illustrations for the book too.
The long-term open pedagogy project that I was embedded in, or I still am embedded in, was piloted this past spring semester in an undergraduate English literature course taught by Dr. Marissa Nicosia, a professor of Renaissance literature at Penn State Abington. The course was redesigned for a couple of reasons: to take advantage of pre and early modern literature, which is largely in the public domain, to involve students in the development of the materials, and to include diverse voices and perspectives. And we were really inspired by Robin DeRosa's open anthology of early American literature after hearing her speak at OpenCon Philly in 2019 and a subsequent conversation with her. So for this project, we used OER anthologies or open digital scholarly editions for the course text. And after a very traditional 10-week seminar style class, we switched over to a final editorial project that asked students to remix, annotate, gloss, and contextualize a course reading of their choice by researching and authoring all of these: an introductory header, 4 footnotes, and to find 2 images for inclusion, if they consent it, in a future open access textbook on transatlantic pre-modern literature. On the left of the slide, you'll see a snippet of the assignment that we gave students. And on the right side, you'll see one of the students who wrote a footnote for Hester Poulter's poem, An Invitation to the Country, along with an image that she researched to go along with the connection that she made in the poem. Like Bryan, we had some lessons that we learned from this, and these helped really inform the Open Pedagogy Project roadmap, all of our lessons learned. So we learned in terms of challenges, right? We needed to do more signposting throughout the course because students really had a lot of questions about what they were actually going to be doing. Even though we'd given them 2 examples writing for a public audience and writing the kinds of formats we were asking them to write, like footnotes and introductions, were not actually formats that they were used to writing. They were used to doing traditional final essays that were submitted to the professor and seen by the professor alone. So that created some anxiety and discomfort for students. So one of the things we learned was to add in some additional consultation time to answer questions, add some additional peer review to get feedback from other students to meet those needs and address some of that discomfort and anxiety. A really great lesson learned, though, despite that anxiety, was that many students were excited, curious, and enthusiastic about the project. Open pedagogy, in my experience, has been very rewarding. In their presentations and their final reflection essays, which are really great things to do when you're doing an open pedagogy project, some things became clear about the student impact of open pedagogy. As a librarian, it was awesome to see so many students talk about their sources. One student said, "I realized it really mattered what my sources were. People were going to read this and see this." Others really talked about a personal connection, chose specific texts because it connected to their heritage, or made connections to the text based on their experiences. And then finally, writing for an authentic audience really resonated with students. We posed the authentic audience as future students in the class and potentially the public. And so students in their reflections kind of made comments around like, "Well, I want to write about things that other students are going to want to read about." So those are some really positive experiences that came out of it. And so based on Bryan and my collective experiences being closely embedded in these open pedagogy projects and our experience supporting other OER programs, we developed what we call the Open Pedagogy Project Roadmap. This is a module-based project management resource that lives on a website. And there's a companion workbook there. And Bryan and I are also happy to do an accompanying workshop at your institution. And this roadmap is designed to guide instructors through planning, finding support for, sharing, and sustaining open pedagogy projects. It's a very practical resource, and it guides instructors through the five S's of open pedagogy projects: their scope, their support, students, sharing, and sustaining. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that it's inspired by the socio-technical sustainability roadmap, which comes out of Allison Langmead's team at the University of Pittsburgh, which focuses on digital humanities. So just a few things to note before we go through the roadmap. It's designed to be practical, both a practical reflection space and a documentation space for the affordances or the benefits of open pedagogy projects. Again, it's instructor facing, but by instructor, we're inclusive of anyone that supports, collaborates on, or leads an open pedagogy project. It's also discipline agnostic, right? So you can use it regardless of what discipline you're working with. We're going to present it in a ABCD fashion in the sections, based on the sections, but ultimately it's really nonlinear. You can complete it in whatever order works for you. And as you go through different sections, you'll likely think of things to go back and add to portions that you've previously completed. The final portion of it asks you to do just that, to go back and note where you have remaining gaps and questions so that you can develop an action plan going forward. It's also adaptable. Adjust as you need, take what works for you and leave the rest, depending on what you need. So Bryan, if you're attending live, is gonna put the link in the chat, but you can access it at oeproadmap.psu.edu. And on the About page is where you'll find the link to the entire workbook. So the roadmap very intentionally begins by having instructors define their values and goals and then their capacity before scoping the project, because these are crucial for determining that scope. You need to know why you're in this and what capacity you have before you can figure out more specifically what you want to do. So basically, we're asking instructors to put aside the what of the project and reflect on the why first. And a central value to think about, because it's not necessarily inherent, is to consider how your project can center diversity, equity, and inclusion. One of the hallmarks of open pedagogy is that it prioritizes access. Because it does prioritize access, but it also prioritizes student access to participatory knowledge creation. And when we do that, when we invite students to bring the whole of themselves to creating or modifying course content will inevitably be changed to reflect the diversity and complexity student identities. So with that in mind, we want you to think about values a little bit more. One of the things we try to highlight in our framing of open pedagogy is that we see it not just about a set of practices, but also about those values and that mindset. It can be that opportunity to center diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility, and we should definitely consider whose voices are missing and how we can include them. So one resource that we point to in this first section of the roadmap, the scope section, is John Gianni's 5 R's for open pedagogy, because it provides a good framework that can be used to examine our values and think about how they can be embedded in open pedagogy. I'm not going to go through them one by one, but I just want to highlight one theme that Bryan's going to touch back on again too, is the idea of agency. We weave that through different pieces of the roadmap, and it's definitely something that in our experience is certainly a really important part of it. So once you've scoped your values, then we ask you to scope your capacity. And capacity includes how much time you really have, where you might benefit from collaborators, and also thinking about ways to maximize your time by looking for OER that might already be available. The final piece of scoping is about beginning to define the parameters of the project itself. Right? What do you want the students to do, how, where? And as you complete the other elements of the roadmap, you'll continue to flesh out the elements of that project idea. Once you've done all that initial scoping, the next section of the roadmap is all about identifying what support is available and what support you'll still need to find in order to have a successful open pedagogy project. And we think of support in 3 separate, distinct elements. So first, structural and systemic support, which is about what's available to you at an institutional level and within your broader disciplinary communities or in consortia or statewide and regional initiatives. So we definitely recommend looking at strategic plans, any kind of departmental documents or guidelines, so you can tie these things at your institution into what you'll be doing, because that will make it an easier sell in your dossier, in conversations with other colleagues or administrators, or in any promotion or tenure material you might be doing. The next type of support is logistical support, which focuses on the humans, the people who can help you, people like librarians, instructional designers, production specialists, accessibility experts, as Bryan had experience with, potentially other student collaborators, right, who might be able to have particular expertise. So kind of look for what's available to you and what you still might need. And the next is technological support. So we want you to identify what kinds of technologies are available to you, are reasonable for you to use in order to do the project, and think about to what degree will students be interacting with those technologies.
So then the next section of the roadmap is really about refining your content and your process that you identified back during that scoping phase in order to think more closely about how all of this relates to students. And so open pedagogy is an opportunity to move beyond just that focus on content mastery and also develop some content agnostic knowledge practices and dispositions. So this section asks you to think about making your learning outcomes less focused on just the content and more focused on the process, as well as considering how you're going to assess those outcomes. And we recognize that not everybody has full autonomy over their grading methodology, you know, particularly folks who are in more precarious or contingent teaching positions. But even if you can't take a more radical approach to grading, like ungrading or other types of methods that rely less on having that kind of summative letter grade, you can still try to incorporate elements for peer review. So meaning students giving feedback to one another on their work, also opportunities for revision and opportunities for reflection. All 3 of those things can still help to foster this open environment within your course. Also, as I alluded to earlier, you know, we need to be mindful of respecting the agency and labor of everybody who's involved in this work. If we fail to do this, then open pedagogy becomes this sort of transactional relationship with students rather than a genuine collaboration. So in this piece, we consider those ethical concerns and things like how students are going to give consent and the role that they have in choosing the license for their work as well. So then the final section of the roadmap asks you to think about how you can share your work and also what it needs to be sustained over the long term. So in terms of sharing, you know, your audiences and your methods for sharing may differ depending upon what your motives are. So are you trying to make other educators more aware about this awesome resource that you created so that they can use it too? Are you trying to raise your profile within your disciplinary community? Do you need to justify your work to administrators? Are you trying to leverage this work for your promotion and tenure? Or maybe if you're on the job market, leveraging it in your job search. So depending on your answers to any of those questions, that's really going to impact how you communicate about your work and the actual venues in which you would want to share it. And then in terms of sustainability, this is about planning for the long term and anticipating what kinds of problems might arise as you go along. And so once you've done all of these different pieces, you can then use any remaining gaps from all of the sections of the roadmap to really determine what your next steps are going to be. So ultimately, this should culminate in determining what some actionable next steps would be. When we run this as a workshop, we like to ask folks to identify steps that they can take right away after the workshop, and then in the coming weeks and months and so forth. Because often, you know, we get excited about these projects or things that we hear about at conferences, and then we go back to work and our day-to-day just kind of gets in the way of all of that. Before you know it, you've lost your momentum. So having those actionable next steps can really help to keep you on task and keep your momentum going. So thank you all for attending today, those of you who are viewing this live. And thank you to everybody who is viewing the recording after the fact. If you have further questions or suggestions for improvements or additions to the roadmap, or you just want to talk open pedagogy, we'd love to hear from you. So our emails are on the slide, as well as our Twitter handles. You can tweet us and use the hashtag OEP roadmap. So thank you again and take care.
Hi, everyone.